Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Allow me to begin on a personal note. This is a picture of me taken right around the time that my grandmother was diagnosed with end-stage heart disease and sent home to die. Confined to a wheelchair, crushing chest pain. Her life was over at age 65. She already had so many bypass surgeries, she basically run out of plumbing at some point. She heard about this guy, Nathan Pritikin, who one of our early lifestyle medicine pioneers. And what happened next is chronicled in Pritikin's biography. My grandma was one of the death's door people, Frances Gregor. My grandma arrived at Pritikin's early sessions in a wheelchair. Mrs. Gregor had heart disease, angina, claudication, conditions so bad she could no longer walk without great pain in her chest and legs. Within 3 weeks, though, she was not only out of her wheelchair, she was walking 10 miles a day. This is a picture of my grandma taken 15 years after she was abandoned by doctors at her grandson's wedding here. She was given her medical death sentence at age 65. Thanks to a healthy diet, was able to live another 31 years on this planet to age 96 to enjoy her 6 grandkids, including me. That's why I went into medicine. When Dr. Dean Ornish published his lifestyle heart trial years later, proving with quantitative angiography that indeed heart disease could be reversed without drugs, without surgery, in the majority of patients with a plant-based diet and other healthy lifestyle changes, I thought this was going to be the game changer. I mean, published in one of the most prestigious medical journals in the world. I mean, my family had, you know, seen it for themselves, but here it was in black and white. Yet, nothing happened. I said, wait a second, if effectively the cure to our number one killer could be ignored, lost down some rabbit hole, what else was there in the medical literature that could help my patients but just didn't have a, you know, corporate budget driving its promotion? Well, I made it my life's mission to find out. For those of you unfamiliar with my work, every year I read through every issue of every English language nutrition journal in the world, so busy folks like you don't have to. Very nice. Everything on the website is free. There's no ads, no corporate sponsorship, strictly non-commercial, not selling anything. Just put it up as a public service, as a labor of love. New videos and articles every day on the latest in evidence-based nutrition. What a concept. So where did Pritikin get his evidence from? Well, a network of missionary hospitals set up throughout sub-Saharan Africa uncovered what may be one of the greatest health advances of the last century, according to one of the most preeminent medical figures of the 20th century, Dr. Dennis Burkitt, the fact that many of our most common and major diseases were universally rare, like heart disease. In the African population of Uganda, for example, coronary heart disease almost non-existent. Wait a second. Our number one cause of death, almost non-existent. What were they eating? Well, they were eating a lot of greens and grains and other vegetables, and their protein sources almost exclusively from plants. And they had the cholesterol levels to prove it, actually very similar to what one sees in kind of modern day plant eaters. He said, wait a second, maybe the Africans were just dying early from something else, never lived long enough to get heart disease. No, here's age-matched heart attack rates in Uganda versus St. Louis. Out of 632 autopsies in Uganda, only one myocardial infarction. Out of 632 age and gender-matched autopsies, 136 myocardial infarctions, more than 100 times the rate of our leading killer. They were so blown away, they went back and did another 800 autopsies in Uganda. Still just that one small healed infarct, meaning it wasn't even the cause of death. Out of 1,427 patients, less than 1 in 1,000, whereas here, coronary heart disease is an epidemic. Here's a list of diseases commonly found here and in places that eat and live like the U.S., but were rare or even non-existent in people in populations eating diets centered around whole plant foods. These are among our most common diseases, like obesity, for example, or hiatal hernia, one of the most common stomach problems, varicose veins and hemorrhoids, the two most common venous problems, colorectal cancer, leading cancer killer, diverticulosis, the most common disease of the intestines, appendicitis, number one cause of emergency abdominal surgery, gallbladder disease, number one cause of non-emergency abdominal surgery, as well as ischemic heart disease, our commonest cause of death here, but a rarity among plant-based populations, which suggests heart disease may be a choice, like cavities. If you look at the teeth of people who lived over 10,000 years before the invention of the toothbrush, pretty much no cavities. Didn't brush a day in their lives, no flossing, yet no cavities. Why? Because candy bars hadn't been invented yet, right? So why do people continue to get cavities when we know they're preventable through diet? Well, simple, because the pleasure people derive from dessert may outweigh the cost and discomfort of the dentist chair. And look, that's fine, right? As long as people understand the consequences of their actions. I mean, as a physician, what more can I do? Right? If you think the benefits outweigh the risk for you and your family, then go for it. I certainly enjoy the occasional indulgence. I've got a good dental plan. But what if instead of the plaque on our teeth, we're talking about the plaque building up inside of our arteries? Another disease that can be prevented through changes in our diet. Okay, now what are the consequences for you and your family? Okay, now we're not talking about scraping tartar anymore. Now we're talking life and death. The most likely reason our loved ones will die is heart disease. It's still up to each of us to make our own decisions as to what to eat and how to live, but we should make these choices consciously, right? Educating ourselves about the predictable consequences of our actions. Atherosclerosis, hardening of the arteries, is a disease that begins in childhood. By age 10, nearly all kids raised on the standard American diet already have these so-called fatty streaks, the first stage of the disease within their arteries, and then these plaques start forming in our 20s, get worse in our 30s, and then can start killing us off. In our heart, it's called a heart attack. In our brain, the same disease is called a stroke. So if there's anyone here this morning older than age 10, then the question is not whether or not to eat healthy to prevent heart disease. It's whether you want to reverse the heart disease that you already have. Is that even possible? You know, when researchers took people with heart disease, put them on the kind of diet followed by populations that did not get heart disease, their hope was to slow down the progression of the disease, maybe even stop it. But instead, something miraculous happened. As soon as people stopped eating artery-clogging diets, their bodies were able to dissolve some of that plaque away, opening up arteries without drugs, without surgery, suggesting their bodies wanted to be healthy all along, but were just never given the chance. This dramatic improvement in blood flow on the left was after just 3 weeks eating healthy. Let me share with you what's been called the best-kept secret in medicine. The best-kept secret in medicine is that sometimes the body can heal itself. You know, if you whack your shin really hard on a coffee table and get all red, hot, painful, swollen, inflamed, but will heal naturally if you just stand back, let your body work its magic. But what if you kept whacking your shin in the same place day after day? In fact, 3 times a day, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. You'd never heal, right? You go to your doctor and be like, oh, my shin hurts. They'd be like, no problem. I trained for this. Whip out their pad, write your prescription for painkillers, right? You're still whacking your shin 3 times a day. Oh, it's still really hurt, but oh, it feels so much better with those pain pills on board. Thank heavens for modern medicine. It's like, you know, taking nitroglycerin for crushing chest pain. I mean, a tremendous relief, but not doing anything to treat the underlying cause. Right? Our body wants to come back to health if we let it. But if we keep re-injuring ourselves 3 times a day, we may never heal. It's like smoking. One of the most amazing things I learned in all my medical training was that within 15 years of stopping smoking, your lung cancer risk approaches that of a lifelong non-smoker. Isn't that amazing that your lungs can clear out all that tar, and eventually it's almost as if you never started smoking at all. And every morning of our smoking life, that healing process started until wham, our first cigarette of the day, re-injuring our lungs with every puff, just like we can re-injure our arteries with every bite, when all we had to do all along, the miracle cure, is to just stop re-damaging ourselves, get out of the way, and let our body's natural healing processes bring us back towards health. Sure, you can choose moderation and hit yourself with a smaller hammer, but why beat yourself up at all? This is nothing new. American Heart Journal, 1977. Cases like Mr. F.W. here. Heart disease so bad, couldn't even make it to the mailbox. Started eating healthier. Few months later, climbing mountains, no pain. Now, there are these fancy new classes of anti-angina drugs on the market now, cost thousands of dollars a year, but at the highest dose can improve exercise duration as long as 33 and a half seconds. You can actually stay on a treadmill 33 and a half seconds longer if you're on these medications. It does not look like those choosing the drug route are going to be climbing mountains anytime soon, right? See, plant-based diets aren't just safer and cheaper, they can work better because you're treating the cause of the disease. The second leading killer in the United States is cancer. What happens if you put cancer on a plant-based diet? Well, Dr. Dean Ornish and colleagues showed that you could reverse the progression of prostate cancer with a plant-based diet and other healthy lifestyle behaviors, and no wonder. If you take blood of those eating the standard American diet, drip that blood on cancer cells growing in a petri dish, you can cut down cancer cell growth by about 9%. You can suppress cancer growth by about 9%. But put people on a plant-based diet for a year, though, and their blood can do this. The blood circulating throughout the bodies of those eating plant-based diets is nearly 8 times the stopping power when it comes to suppressing cancer cell growth. Now, this was for men and prostate cancer. They wanted to repeat the study using women and breast cancer, the number one cancer killer specific to women. But look, they didn't want to wait a whole year to get the results. Women are dying now, so let's see what a healthy diet can do after just 2 weeks. Against 3 different lines of human breast cancer. This is the before picture, cancer cell growth powering away at 100%, and then this is after eating healthy for just 2 weeks. This is kind of the before picture. This is a photograph taken under a microscope. And what the researchers did is laid down a confluent layer of human breast cancer, so kind of a carpet of breast cancer, dripped blood of women eating the standard American diet onto that cancer. And you can see it kind of breaks the cancer up into these kind of cancer continents here. And then you take these same women, put them on a plant-based diet, and retest 2 weeks later. So they act as their own controls. Same women, 2 weeks later, draw their blood again after eating healthy for 2 weeks, and lay down another carpet of breast cancer, and all you're left with is this. Just a few individual cancer cells left before and after just 2 weeks eating a plant-based diet. Their bodies became that much more hostile to cancer. Suppressing cancer growth is nice. Getting rid of it is even better. This is what's called apoptosis, programmed cell death. Bodies are able to kind of reprogram cancer cells, forcing them into early retirement. This is what's called tunnel imaging, measuring DNA fragmentation, cell death, where dying cancer cells show up as little white spots. So again, this is the before picture, drip blood of women eating the standard American diet onto cancer cells growing in a petri dish. You can see here's one cancer cell dying. So you're not totally defenseless, even if you're eating a pretty poor diet. Then you take these same women 2 weeks later, and their blood can do this. It's like you're an entirely different person inside. The blood circulating throughout these bodies of these women gained the power to significantly slow down and stop breast cancer cell growth after just 2 weeks eating healthy. What kind of blood do we want in our body? What kind of immune system? Do we want blood just kind of rolls over when new cancer cells pop up? Or do we want blood circulating to every nook and cranny in our body with the power to slow down and stop it? Now, this dramatic strengthening of cancer defenses was after 2 weeks of diet and exercise. They had these women out walking 30 to 60 minutes a day. You say, well, wait a second. If you do two things, I mean, how do you know what role the diet played? And so researchers decided to put it to the test. This is measuring apoptosis, programmed cell death, and so this is what we saw before. The cancer cell clearance of those eating a healthy diet and exercise, in this case, on average for 14 years, plant-based diet for 14 years, along with just mild exercise like out walking every day. For diet and exercise, that's the kind of cancer cell clearance you get. Compare that to the cancer-stopping power of your average sedentary American. See the little burger? I don't know if you can see the little burger in the hand. Which is practically non-existent. All right. But here's the interesting group in the middle. What if you take a group of people, 14 years of not a plant-based, 14 years standard American diet, but 14 years of daily, strenuous, hour-long exercise like calisthenics. They wanted to know if you exercise long enough, if you exercise hard enough, can you rival some strolling plant eaters over there? And the answer is exercise helped, no question. But literally 5,000 hours in the gym was no match for a plant-based diet. This is that same tunnel imaging as we saw before. Even if you're a couch potato eating fried potatoes, you are not totally defenseless. You can knock off a few cancer cells. If you exercise for 5,000 hours, you can knock off cancer cells left and right, but nothing appears to kick more cancer tush than a plant-based diet. We think this is because eating animal proteins, meat, egg white, and dairy proteins, increases the levels of IGF-1 in our body, insulin-like growth factor 1, a cancer-promoting growth hormone involved in the acquisition and progression of malignant tumors. But if you go on a plant-based diet, reduce your intake of animal protein, IGF-1 levels drop within your body. If you do it for a long time, they drop even further. And your levels of IGF-1 binding protein go up. IGF-1 binding protein is one of our body's ways to protect itself from cancer, protect itself from excessive growth. Sure, in as few as 2 weeks, your levels of IGF-1 in your body, the production can drop. But what about all the IGF-1 you had from, you know, the bacon and eggs you had 3 weeks ago? Well, your liver releases this snatch squad of binding proteins into the circulation to tie up any excess IGF-1, pull it out of the system like your body's emergency brake, and your protective levels go up within weeks, and benefits continue to accrue the longer you eat healthy. Here's the experiment that really nailed IGF-1 as the villain. As we saw before, start eating healthy and exercising, cancer cell growth drops, cancer cell death shoots up. But here's the interesting column here. What if you add back to the cancer just the amount of IGF-1 you banish from your system by eating healthy? What happens? You erase the diet and exercise effect. It's almost as if you never started eating healthy at all. So, going on a plant-based diet reduces one's level of IGF-1, which reduces cancer growth, which may explain why the largest study on cancer and diet in history, prospective study, found the incidence of all cancers combined was lower among those eating more plant-based diets. How much lower are we talking about? Well, those eating lots of protein middle age, 75% increase in overall mortality, fourfold increase in risk of dying from cancer, but not all proteins, specifically just the animal protein, which makes sense given the higher IGF-1 levels. The sponsoring academic institution sent out a press release with a memorable opening line: "That chicken wing you're eating could be as deadly as a cigarette." Noting that, you know, that eating lots of animal protein during middle age makes one four times more likely to die from cancer, which is comparable to what one might see when one is smoking. What was the nutrition community's response to this revelation that diets high in meat, eggs, and dairy could be harmful to health as smoking? Well, one nutrition scientist said it was potentially dangerous to compare the effects of smoking, to compare it to the effects of meat and cheese. Why? Because a smoker might think, hey, why bother quitting smoking if my ham and cheese sandwich is just as bad for me? It reminds me of this famous Philip Morris cigarette ad that tried to downplay the risks of secondhand smoke by saying, look, you think secondhand smoke is bad, increasing the risk of lung cancer 19%. Well, hey, drinking one or two glasses of milk every day, maybe three times as bad, 62% increased risk of lung cancer. Or doubling your risk frequently cooking with oil, tripling your risk of heart disease eating non-vegetarian, multiplying your risk sixfold if you eat lots of meat and dairy. So, they conclude, let's keep some perspective here. The risks from secondhand smoke may be well below that of other everyday activities, so breathe deep. That's like saying, yeah, don't worry about getting stabbed, because getting shot, so much worse. How about neither? Two risks don't make a right. Of course, you'll note Philip Morris stopped throwing dairy under the bus once they purchased Kraft Foods. Just saying. All right, only 13 causes of death to go. What time is that? That's why you start early in the morning. We can. The top three killers used to be heart disease, cancer, stroke. Oh, that's so 2007. Now it's heart disease, cancer, and COPD. Chronic obstructive pulmonary diseases like emphysema. Thankfully, a healthy plant-based diet can help prevent COPD, even help treat COPD, significantly improving lung function over time, something we didn't even think was possible. But, you know, the tobacco industry viewed these landmark findings a little differently. I mean, if adding plants to our diet can improve lung function, wouldn't it be easier to just add plants to cigarettes? And indeed, the addition of acai berries to cigarettes evidently has a protective effect against emphysema in smoking mice. Who would have thunk it? Next, they're going to start adding berries to meat. And indeed, I couldn't make this stuff up, ladies and gentlemen. The addition of fruit extracts to burger patties was not without its glitches. For example, the blackberries dyed the burger patties a distinct purplish color, which kind of turned people off a little bit. Though evidently you can improve the tenderness of lamb carcasses if you infuse them before rigor mortis sets in with kiwi fruit juice. You can even improve the nutritional profile of frankfurters by adding powdered grape seeds, though there were complaints of grape seed particles becoming visible in the final product. And I mean, if there's one thing we know about hot dog eaters, it's that they're picky about what goes in their food. Oh, pig anus, but grape seeds, oh! Killer number four is strokes. Preventing strokes may be all about eating potassium-rich foods, yet most Americans don't even reach the recommended minimum daily intake of potassium, and by most, I'm talking more than 98%. More than 98% of Americans eat potassium deficient diets because 98% of us don't eat enough plants. Potassium comes from the words potash. Take any plant, put it in a pot, reduce the ash, boil it off, you're left with something called potassium, vegetable alkali. True story. But who can name me one plant food in particular high in potassium?
Bananas,
of course. I don't know why that's like the one thing everybody knows about nutrition. I'm not exactly sure why. Chiquita must have had a great PR firm or something, but turns out bananas don't even make the top 50 sources of potassium, coming in at number 86, right behind fast food vanilla milkshakes. It goes fast food, then bananas. It's funny. When I was writing the new book, I went back just to make sure the USDA hadn't changed the nutrient database, and it turns out they had. They expanded it. Now bananas don't even make the top 1,000 sources, coming in at number 1,611, right after Reese's Pieces. I kid you not. Most concentrated sources of potassium in the diet are beet greens, greens in general, beans, and dates. Greens, beans, and dates. Bananas don't even make the top 1,000. In fact, if you look at the next leading cause of death, bananas could be downright dangerous. Alzheimer's disease is the next sixth leading killer. You know, 10 years ago, wasn't even in the top 10. 4 million Americans affected, according to the latest dietary recommendations for the prevention of Alzheimer's. The two most important things we can do is reduce our intake of meat, dairy, and junk, and replace those foods with vegetables, legumes, which are beans, split peas, chickpeas, and lentils, fruits, whole grains. And this is based in part on data going back decades now that shows that those people that eat meat, red meat, white meat, doesn't matter, between 2 to 3 times the risk of becoming demented later in life. And the longer one eats a plant-based diet, the lower one's risk drops. Next on the list is type 2 diabetes, a disease that can be prevented, arrested, and reversed with a plant-based diet, something we've known since the 1930s. In this case, eliminating insulin dependence, so taking people off insulin in a quarter of the diabetics after 5 years on this diet. But the plant-based diets are relatively low-calorie diets. I mean, so maybe their diabetes got so much better just because they lost so much weight. Maybe it wouldn't matter how you lost weight. As long as you lost weight, that'll improve diet. In fact, you can even go in for bariatric surgery, like, you know, stomach stapling the surgery, and you can cure people from diabetes. So to see if there were unique benefits of plant-based diets beyond just all the weight loss, what you'd need to do is design a study where you put people on a plant-based diet, but force them to eat so much food that they don't lose weight despite eating healthy. Then we could see if there's something special about plant-based diets. Well, we'd have to wait 45 years, but here it is. They weighed research subjects every day, and if they started to lose weight, they were made to eat more food. In fact, so much more food. Some of the participants had problems eating at all. They're like, oh, not another salad. Oh. But eventually they adapted, and so no weight loss. So wait a second. So did a plant-based diet still help their diabetes, even with zero weight loss? Well, insulin needs were cut on average 60%, and half of the diabetics ended off of all their insulin altogether. How many years did this take? No, 16 days. 16 days later. So we're talking people, for example, diabetes for 20 years on 20 units of insulin, and 13 days later on none. Diabetes for 20 years and off all insulin in less than 2 weeks, even without any weight loss. Diabetes for 20 years because no one had told her about a plant-based diet. Here's patient number 15, 32 units on average on the control diet, and then 18 days later on none. lower blood sugars on 32 units less insulin. That's the power of plants. And as a bonus, cholesterol dropped like a rock to an average under 150 in less than two weeks. You know, just like modest changes in diet are only going to give you modest benefits in cholesterol, you know, how moderate do you want your diabetes? Right? Everything in moderation is a, you know, truer statement than many people realize, right? Asking diabetics to make moderate changes in their diet can leave them with moderate blindness, moderate kidney failure, moderate amputation, maybe just a few toes or something. Right? Moderation in all things is not necessarily a good thing. So, remember that study that purported to show that diets high in meat, eggs, dairy could be harmful to health as smoking supposedly suggested that eating lots of meat, eggs, and dairy makes you four times as likely to die from cancer or diabetes. But if you look at the actual study, you'll see that's not true. Those eating lots of animal protein didn't have four times the risk of dying from diabetes. They had 73 times the risk of dying from diabetes. Now, those that chose moderation, eating just a moderate amount of animal protein, they only had 23 times the risk of death from diabetes. Killer number 8 is kidney failure, a disease that can be prevented, arrested, reversed with a plant-based diet, and no wonder. Kidneys are highly vascular organs. Harvard researchers discovered 3 dietary risk factors for declining kidney function. Number 1, animal protein. Number 2, animal fat. Number 3, cholesterol. Animal fat can alter the actual structure of human kidneys based on studies like this showing plugs of fat basically clogging up the works in autopsied kidneys. And animal protein can have a profound effect on normal kidney function, inducing what's called hyperfiltration, increasing the workload on the kidneys, but not plant protein. So, for example, if you take people and you give them some tuna fish, you see increased pressure in the kidneys 1, 2, 3 hours after the meal in both non-diabetics and diabetics. Right? So we're not talking adverse effects decades down the road from one's food choices, but literally minutes within it going into our mouths. But what if instead of tuna fish, what if you ate the exact same amount of protein, but instead of having a tuna fish salad sandwich, you had a tofu salad sandwich? Nothing happens. Your kidneys can handle, you know, plant protein without even batting an eyelash. So why does animal protein cause that overload reaction but not plant protein? We think it's because the inflammation triggered by animal protein within the body. How do we know that? Because if you give a powerful anti-inflammatory drug along with that tuna fish, you can abolish that protein leakage hyperfiltration response to meat ingestion. And then there's the acid load. So animal foods tend to induce the formation of acid within the kidneys, which can lead to something called tubular toxicity, damage to the delicate urine-making tubes within the kidneys. Animal foods in general tend to be acid-forming, whereas plant foods are either neutral or actually base-forming, alkaline, and therefore kind of counteracting some of the acid formation within the diet. So the key to halting the progression of chronic kidney disease may lie in the produce aisle rather than the pharmacy. No surprise, then, that plant-based diets have been used to treat kidney dysfunction for decades. So this is protein leakage on the standard low-salt diet, what physicians would typically put kidney patients on. Then they tried switching them to the supplemented vegan diet, then back to conventional, plant-based, switching on and off kidney dysfunction like a light switch based on what was going into their mouths. Killer number 9, respiratory infection. You say, well, wait a second, what possible role could diet play in respiratory infections? Obviously, you haven't seen my video, Kale and the Immune System, talking about the immunostimulatory effects of kale. Is there anything kale cannot do? It tastes good. Did you hear that? That's funny. See, the problem is, I think we all have flashbacks to our childhood of overcooked gray lumps on cafeteria school trays. But that's, people don't know how to cook greens. There are ways you can cook greens, even strongly flavored greens like mustard greens and kale, to make them delicious. All about the sauces, how you cook them. And you can, where's Amy? Where'd Amy go? There she is. Amy can tell you how to cook greens. She can be your local resource for delicious kale recipes. Are we gonna have any in the smoothies afterwards? Kale in the smoothie. You don't think kale can taste good? Wait for the smoothies at the end. Perfect, very nice segue there. All right. Kale, boosting antibody production sevenfold. Okay, but this is in a petri dish. What about in people? You take older men and women, their 60s and 70s, split them up into two groups. Half continue to eat their regular diet. The other half just ate a few more servings of fruits and vegetables right before getting their Pneumovax vaccination, their pneumonia vaccination. What you see is a significantly boosted protective antibody response in the higher fruit and vegetable group. And so this is not, you know, cutting out meat. Just adding a few servings of produce to one's daily diet can significantly boost one's immune function. Next on the list, killer number 10 is actually suicide. We've known that people that eat healthier feel healthier. About half of the, on average, of the depression, half of the anxiety, half of the stress scores compared to those who eat meat. Researchers think this may be because of the arachidonic acid in animal products. Arachidonic acid is this inflammatory omega-6 fatty acid found predominantly actually in chicken and eggs. Those are two most largest sources of the American diet. So if you take people and you remove meat, remove fish, remove poultry, remove eggs as well from the diet, you can see a significant improvement in mood within just 2 weeks after doing that. And so researchers think that it's because this arachidonic acid is adversely impacting mental health via a cascade of neuroinflammation, brain inflammation, but we can clear out the inflammation from our brains within just 2 weeks by cutting down on eggs, chicken, and other meat. Am I just cherry picking here? I mean, what about all the other randomized controlled trials showing that different diets improved mood? There aren't any. So the latest review found only that plant-based diet intervention fulfilled their kind of rigorous criteria for scientific validity. So you know, it's kind of hard to cherry pick when there's only one cherry. Works in a workplace setting too. Researchers went into Geico Insurance and encouraged people to start eating healthy. Got significant improvements in physical functioning, general health, vitality, mental health. This was then expanded across 10 corporate sites at Geico. Also, of course, improved worker productivity, which is, of course, all corporations care about, the bottom line. So, across 10 corporate sites now, so they split them up into two different sites. So half the sites were control sites where they did nothing. The other half, they just went in and did educational seminars like this and improved, and gave additional plant-based options in the cafeteria, like they added lentil soup, little things like that. So, I mean, they didn't force people to eat this way. They just gave them information and a few more options. And what did we find? Significant improvements in depression, anxiety, fatigue, emotional well-being, daily functioning, as well as mental health, emotional health. And so these lifestyle interventions, such as exercise, can significantly improve both mental as well as physical health. And in terms of diet-wise, it's these plant-based diets shown to be most effective so far. Killer number 11. Or blood infections. Sure, you know, foodborne illness, bacteria can kind of burrow through the intestinal wall and invade the bloodstream, but in women may creep up into their bladder. We've known for decades that it's bacteria creeping up from the rectum that actually cause bladder infections, but only recently did we discover where this rectal reservoir of bladder-infecting E. coli was coming from, and now we know it's chicken. We now have DNA fingerprinting proof of a direct link between meat, farm animals, meat, and bladder infections, solid evidence that urinary tract infections can be what's called a zoonosis, an animal to human disease. I said, wait a second, I mean, can't you just use a meat thermometer, cook the meat through, what's the big deal? Well, the big deal is what's called cross-contamination. If you take 40 families, give them frozen chicken to prepare and cook in their home as they normally would, a multitude of antibiotic-resistant E. coli jump from the kitchen, from the chicken, excuse me, into the guts of the volunteers even before they eat it. So you could incinerate that chicken to ash. You don't even have to eat any of it. You're already infected before it makes it into the oven due to cross-contamination of kitchen surfaces, and within a few days, the chicken bacteria had multiplied to the point of becoming major parts of these people's gut flora, so the chicken bacteria was like taking over. You say, well, wait a second, what if you do not only you cook it well, but you use proper handling guidelines? This is the official USDA recommendations. We're actually supposed to be using a bleach solution on all kitchen surfaces, then we spray a bleach solution on all, you know, doorknobs, fridge handle, oven, you know, knobs, all that stuff. So they had people did that, then came in later and swabbed around their kitchen. What did they find? Significant levels of Campylobacter, Salmonella, serious human pathogens still left behind. In fact, the reason that there tends to be more bacteria from feces in people's kitchen sink than on their toilet seat is because people tend to wash chickens in their sink, not their toilet. So unless our kitchen is like some biohazard lab, the only way we're going to guarantee not leaving infection around the kitchen is to not bring it into our homes in the first place. Now, the good news is, it's not like you eat chicken once, you're colonized for life. In this study here, the chicken bacteria only seemed to last about 10 days before your good bacteria could muscle it out of the way. The problem is that many families, you know, buy chicken more than once every 10 days, and so maybe constantly reintroducing these chicken bugs into their systems. You say, wait a second, you can't sell unsafe toys, you can't sell unsafe cars. How is it even legal to sell unsafe meat? Well, they do it by blaming the consumers. One USDA poultry microbiologist said, look, raw meats are not idiot-proof. They can be mishandled, and when they are, it's like handling a hand grenade. You pull the pin, someone's going to get hurt. Right. Now, while some may question the wisdom of selling hand grenades in supermarkets, our poultry microbiologist disagrees, saying, no, consumers have the most responsibility, we just refuse to accept it. It's like a car company saying, yeah, we installed faulty brakes, but it's your fault for not putting your kid in a seatbelt. You know, the head of the food poisoning division at the CDC famously responded to this blame the victim attitude coming from the meat industry. She asked, is it reasonable? Is it reasonable that if a consumer undercooks a hamburger, their three-year-old dies? Is that reasonable? Not to worry, though, the meat industry's on it. They just got FDA approval for a bacteria-eating virus that they can spray on the meat. Now, there's been some concern about consumer acceptance of these so-called bacteriophages may present somewhat of a challenge to the food industry, so, of course, I'm not going to label it or anything, but if you think that's going to be a challenge, check out their other bright idea. The effect of extracted housefly pupae, this is a sciencey way of saying they want to smear a maggot mixture on the meat. What? It's a low cost, think about it. Look, maggots thrive off of rotting flesh. However, there have been no reports of maggots having any serious diseases. So hey, they must be filled with some kind of antibacterial something, right? Have you ever seen a maggot sneeze? I don't think so. So, let's take some maggots, grow them 3 days old, wash them off, towel them off, a little Vitamix action here, and voila! Safer meat. We covered kidney failure. What about liver failure? We've known for decades that you can actually treat liver failure with a plant-based diet, significantly reducing the toxins that would otherwise build up in one system, eating meat without a fully functional liver to detoxify your blood. Though one does have to admit there are some people eating plant-based diets with worsening liver function. they're called alcoholics, living off of corn and grapes and barley, strictly plant-based, in fact, but not doing so good. It's not clear what the... Next on the list is high blood pressure, affecting nearly 78 million Americans. That's one in three American adults. And as we age, our pressures get higher and higher, such that by age 60, the majority of us are hypertensive. You say, well, wait a second. I mean, if most of us get it when we get older, I mean, maybe it's less a disease and really just an inevitable consequence of aging. No. We've known since the 1920s that high blood pressure need not occur. Measured the blood pressure of 1,000 people in rural Kenya who ate a diet centered around grains, beans, vegetables, fruit, and greens. And what did they find? They found that our blood pressures go up as we age. Their blood pressures go down. Their blood pressures get better. And indeed, the lower, the better. We now know that even blood pressures under 120 over 80, I mean, if you went to your doctor and had 120 over 80, you'd get a gold star, right? But this 140 over 90 cutoff is arbitrary. Even blood pressures under 120 over 80 appear to benefit from blood pressure reduction. So the ideal blood pressure, the no benefit from reducing it further blood pressure, is 110 over 70. 110 over 70, is it even possible to get our pressures down to 110 over 70? It's not just possible, it's normal for those eating healthy enough diets. So over 2 years at this rural hospital, 1,800 patients were admitted. How many cases of high blood pressure did they find? Zero. Wow, they must have had low rates of heart disease. No, they had no rates of heart disease. Not a single case of atherosclerosis, our number one killer, was found. Same thing in rural China. 110 over 70 their entire lives. 70-year-olds with the same average blood pressure as 16-year-olds. Now, obviously, Africa, China, vastly different diets, but what they shared in common was that they were plant-based day to day, with meat only eaten on special occasions. Now, why do we think it's the plant-based nature of their diets that was so protective? Because in the Western world, as the American Heart Association has pointed out, the only folks getting it down that low were those eating strictly plant-based diets, coming in at about 110 over 65. The largest study of plant-based eaters in history, looking at 89,000 Californians, comparing meat eaters to so-called flexitarians, to those that cut out all meat except fish, to those that cut out all meat, period, to those that cut eat all meat, eggs, and dairy, you see this stepwise drop in high blood pressure rates as one gets more and more plant-based. Same thing with obesity and diabetes, a stepwise progression as a diet gets healthier and healthier. Now, note two things. First, of course, we can throw the majority of our risk out the window for the leading killers eating strictly plant-based, but just as important, it's not black and white, it's not all or nothing. Significant improvements anywhere along the way, any movement we can make along the spectrum towards eating healthy, can accrue significant benefits. So, we can put this to the test. You take vegetarians, give them meat, pay them enough to eat it, and their blood pressures go up. Or you take people that eat meat, remove meat from their diet, blood pressures go down. Within just 7 days, and this is after most of them had already discontinued their blood pressure medications, they had to stop their blood pressure medications because otherwise their blood pressures would drop too low. If you treat the cause of the disease, you can't be on blood pressure drugs. So lower pressures on fewer drugs. That's the power of plants. So, does the American Heart Association recommend a no-meat diet? No, they recommend a low-meat diet called the DASH, so-called DASH diet, the only diet ever officially promoted by our government, because there's just so much evidence showing that it's beneficial. So, wait a second. When the DASH diet was being created, were they just not aware of this landmark research done by Harvard's Frank Sachs? No, they were aware. The chair of the design committee that came up with the DASH diet was Frank Sachs. See, the DASH diet was created with the number one goal capturing the blood pressure lowering benefits of a vegetarian diet, yet contain enough animal products to make it palatable to the general population. They didn't think the public could handle the truth. Now, you can see what they were thinking, right? Just like drugs never work unless you actually take them, diets never work unless you actually eat them. So they're like, look, no one's going to go on a strictly plant-based diet, right? But if we soft pedal the message, maybe on a population scale, we actually might help more people. All right, tell that to the 1,000 U.S. families a day that lose a family member to high blood pressure. Maybe it's time to start telling the American public the truth. Killer number 14 is Parkinson's disease. Can a plant-based diet reduce one's risk of Parkinson's disease? Well, we know that nearly every study done to date looking at dairy products in Parkinson's show increased risk. Why might that be? Well, there's evidence that the milk supply is contaminated with neurotoxic chemicals such as pesticides, other pollutants, found not only in the brains of Parkinson's patients on autopsy, but also in the milk supply. We're talking about compounds like tetrahydroisoquinoline, which is actually what scientists use to try to recreate this disease in primates in the laboratory, found mostly in cheese, actually. So there's been recommendations that the dairy industry kind of self-police themselves and screen their own milk for toxins. Good luck with that. Of course, you could just not drink it, but then what would happen to your bones? That's a marketing ploy. If you look at the actual science, you'll see that the milk does not appear to protect against hip fracture risk, whether you're drinking as an adult, whether you're drinking as a teen, doesn't matter, doesn't work. In fact, may even increase fracture risk, which may explain why those populations that eat the most dairy actually have the highest hip fracture risk. So scientists in Sweden decided to put it to the test. 100,000 men and women followed up for up to 20 years, and milk-drinking women had higher rates of what? Higher rates of death. More heart disease, significantly more cancer for each glass of milk. Women that drank 3 glasses of milk a day had nearly twice the risk of premature death. And they had more bone and hip fractures too. More milk, more fractures. And men also had higher rates of death. Yet for some reason, you don't see milk ads like this. I don't know. But I had the ambulance drive by just at that moment to really put the point in there. Thank you. And then killer number 15, which is just aspiration pneumonia, which is caused by swallowing difficulties due to a stroke or Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, things we've already covered. So here's the 15 leading reasons that Americans die, and a plant-based diet can help prevent nearly all of them, can be used to treat more than half of them, and even reverse the course of disease in some of them, including, in some cases, our top 3 killers. Now, you know, there are drugs that can help too, certainly for, you know, heart disease. You can take cholesterol-lowering statin drugs. For diabetes, there's insulin injections, various oral hypoglycemics. For high blood pressure, usually it takes a few different classes of high blood pressure medications to push one's blood pressure down. But the same diet does it all. It's not like there's a heart-healthy diet that's somehow different from the brain-healthy diet or a kidney-healthy diet. No, a liver-healthy diet is a kidney-healthy diet, is a body-healthy diet, one diet to rule them all. And what about side effects? I'm not talking about a little rash here, but side effects from prescription drugs kill. More than 100,000 Americans every year. Say, wait a second, 100,000 Americans every year, that means the 6th leading cause of death in the United States is doctors. Yes. The 6th leading cause of death is me. Thankfully, I can be prevented with a plant-based diet. No, seriously, compared to 15,000 American vegetarians, those that eat meat, about twice as likely to be on aspirin, sleeping pills, tranquilizers, antacids, painkillers, blood pressure medications, laxatives, of course. as well as insulin. So plant-based diets are great for people that don't like taking drugs, for people that don't like paying for drugs, and for people that don't like risking drug side effects. Right? Want to solve the healthcare crisis? I've got a suggestion. There's only one diet that's ever been proven to reverse heart disease in the majority of patients, this plant-based diet. So, you know, anytime anyone tries to sell you on some new diet they heard about, do me a favor. Ask them one simple question. Say, wait a second, has this new diet been proven to reverse heart disease and the number one reason me and all my loved ones will die? If the answer is no, why would you even consider it? If that's all a plant-based diet could do, reverse our number one killer of men and women, shouldn't that kind of be the default diet until proven otherwise? And the fact that can also be effective in preventing, treating, or reversing other leading killers like type 2 diabetes and hypertension would seem to make the case for plant-based eating simply overwhelming. The number one killer. Most deaths in the United States are preventable and related to nutrition. The number one cause of death in the United States and the number one cause of disability in the United States is our diet, bumping tobacco smoking to number two. Now cigarettes only kill about 500,000 Americans every year, whereas our diet kills hundreds of thousands more. So let me end with a thought experiment. Imagine yourself a smoker in the 1950s. You know, the average per capita cigarette consumption was 4,000 cigarettes a year, meaning like the average person walking around smoked a half pack a day. The media was telling you to smoke, famous athletes agreed, even Santa Claus wanted you to smoke. I mean, look, you want to keep fit and stay slender, so you make sure to smoke and eat lots of hot dogs to stay trim, and eat lots of sugar to stay slim and trim, a lot better than that apple there. I mean, sheesh, right? Although apples do connote goodness and freshness, reads this internal tobacco industry memo, which brings up many possibilities for a youth-oriented cigarette. They want to make apple-flavored cigarettes for kids. Shameless. But for digestion's sake, you smoke. I mean, no curative power is claimed by Philip Morris, but hey, better be safe than sorry, and smoke, right? Blow in her face and she'll follow you anywhere. No woman ever says no, they're so round, so firm, so fully packed. After all, John Wayne smoked them until he got lung cancer and died. You know, back then, even the paleo folks were smoking. And so were the doctors. Now, this is not to say there wasn't controversy within the medical profession. Yes, some doctors smoked Camels, you know, but others preferred Lucky. So there was a little disagreement there. The leader of the U.S. Senate agreed. I mean, who wouldn't want to give their throat a vacation? Not a single case of throat irritation. How could there be when cigarettes are just as pure as the water you drink? Maybe in Flint, Michigan. If you do get irritated, no problem. Your doctor can write you a prescription for cigarettes. This is an ad in the Journal of the American Medical Association. So when the AMA is saying that the smoking on balance may be beneficial, right? When the American Medical Association is saying that, where could you turn if you just wanted the facts? What's the new data advanced by science? Well, hey, she was too tired for fun, and then she smoked a Camel. Babe Ruth spoke of proof positive medical science, that is, when he still could speak before he died of throat cancer. You know, if by some miracle there were some smokingfacts.org website back then that could deliver the science directly bypassing commercially corruptible institutional filters, you would have become aware of studies like this. This is an Inventus study out of California published in 1958 showing that non-smokers had at least 90% less lung cancer than smokers. But this wasn't the first. When famed surgeon Michael DeBakey was asked why his studies back in the 30s linking smoking and lung cancer were simply ignored, he had to remind people what it was like back then. We were a smoking society. It was on TV, it was in the movies, medical meetings were one heavy haze of smoke. Smoking was, in a word, normal. So, back to our thought experiment, right? If you're a smoker in the 50s, in the know, right, what do you do? With access to the science, you realize the best available balance of evidence suggests your smoking habit not so good for you. So do you change or do you wait? I mean, if you wait until your doctor tells you, between puffs, to quit, you'd have cancer by then. If you wait until the powers that be officially recognize it, like the Surgeon General did in the subsequent decade, you could be dead by then. It took 25 years for the first Surgeon General's report to come out. It took more than 7,000 studies and the deaths of countless smokers before the first report by the Surgeon General came out against smoking. You'd think maybe after the first 6,000 studies it could have given people a little heads up or something? No, powerful industry, right? So on one hand, if you're a smoker in the 50s, on one hand you have all of science, all of society, all of the medical profession itself, right? The media telling you to smoke. And on the other hand, all you had was the science. If you were even aware of studies like this. Let's fast forward 55 years. You know, there's a new Adventist study out of California warning Americans about something else they may be putting in their mouth. But it wasn't just one study. According to one of the latest reviews, some total of evidence shows that mortality from all causes combined, including cancer, diabetes, stroke, et cetera, is significantly lower among those eating more plant-based diets. So instead of a smoker in the 50s, imagine you or someone you love going along with America's eating habits today. What do you do? With access to the science, you realize the best available balance of evidence suggests that your eating habits not so good for you. So do you change or do you wait? I mean, if you wait until your doctor tells you, between bites, it could be too late. In fact, even after the Surgeon General's report came out, the medical community still dragged their feet. In fact, the AMA officially came out refusing to endorse the Surgeon General's report. Why? Could it be because they just got a $10 million check from the tobacco industry? All right, so we know why the AMA was sucking up to the tobacco industries, but why weren't more individual doctors speaking out? Well, there were a few gallant souls ahead of their time speaking up against industries killing millions, but why not more? Maybe it's because the majority of physicians themselves smoked cigarettes. Just like the majority of physicians today continue to eat foods that are contributing to our epidemics of dietary disease. What was the AMA's rallying cry back then? Everything in moderation. Extensive scientific studies have proven smoking in moderation, oh, that's fine. Sound familiar? Today, the food industry uses the same tobacco industry tactics, twisting the science, misinformation. The same scientists for hire paid to downplay the risks of secondhand smoke and toxic chemicals. The same hired by the National Confectioners Association to downplay the risks of candy. And the same played by the meat industry to downplay the risks of meat. Animal foods and processed foods result in the deaths of at least 14 million people every year. 14 million people dead every year. Today, plant-based diets can be considered kind of the nutritional equivalent of stopping smoking. How many more people have to die, though, before the CDC says, don't wait for open-heart surgery to start eating healthy as well? Until the system changes, We need to take personal responsibility for our own health, for our family's health. We can't wait till society catches up to the science again, because it's a matter of life and death. You know, last year, Dr. Kim Williams became president of the American College of Cardiology. He was asked in an interview why he himself follows the same diet that he recommends to all his patients, a plant-based diet. "I don't mind dying," Dr. Williams replied. "I just don't want it to be my own fault." Thank you very much. So I think the question can boil down to, what if you eat vegan, what if you eat plant-based, and your cholesterol is still too high, right? Over 150, we want total cholesterol under 150 to make us essentially heart attack proof, or an LDL down around 50, 60, 70. Okay, so what if you're not eating the three things that increase your cholesterol, which is saturated fat, trans fats, and dietary cholesterol? What if you cut those out of your diet and you're still too high? Do you have to worry? Because at least you're not getting that animal cholesterol anymore. The only cholesterol in your body is that produced endogenously by your liver. And the answer is, you are still at risk. If you are, no matter what you eat, your cholesterol is too high, it'll build up into your arteries and could potentially kill you. Now, certainly there's all sorts of wonderful things about eating a plant-based diet that can decrease risk, increasing endothelial function and antioxidants, so it'll be less oxidized cholesterol and less inflammation, and you know, if you're eating a healthy diet. So I have people in my practice. So I have vegans in my practice with significant heart disease, and they've been vegan for 20 years. Why? Their cholesterol is too high. So what do you do? Well, you're saying you already cut out all the stuff that's increasing your cholesterol. So what do you do? Well, then you have to add foods to your diet that actively draw cholesterol from your body. So just because the average cholesterol of those eating strictly plant-based is 147, that's a bell curve. That doesn't mean there aren't people that fall above 150. And so then what do you add to your diet? You add soluble fiber foods, slimy foods like okra, oatmeal, ground flax seeds, eggplant, that actively pulls cholesterol out of your body. You eat nuts every day, you eat soy, there's a whole list of foods you add to your diet. And of course, you make sure there's not some what's called secondary cause of hypercholesterolemia, meaning something non-diet related, for example, hypothyroidism. If you have an underactive thyroid gland, your cholesterol is sky high no matter what you eat. There's other causes too, you just need to talk to your doctor about bringing it down. But what you can't do is say, "I'm vegan, I don't have to worry about my cholesterol." So there's a drug called warfarin, a brand name Coumadin, used as a rat poison and blood thinner, by interfering with vitamin K in the body, interfering with recycling of vitamin K in the body. And vitamin K is important for clotting, so if you interfere with that, all of a sudden you don't clot as well, which is good if you have a mechanical heart valve or some kind of something in your body that could clot off, and so it could save your life. The problem is, what if you're on Coumadin and you eat something with a lot of vitamin K in it, like dark green leafy vegetables? That's the number one source. And so what doctors say is, don't eat dark green leafy vegetables if you're on Coumadin. That's the wrong advice. The reason they give that advice is because they know no one is ever eating dark green leafy vegetables. So they're in effect saying, continue to not eat any dark green leafy vegetables. What they should say is, eat massive amounts of dark green leafy vegetables and then maintain that level. All you need is a consistent level, and then you just titrate the dose of the drug to match your greens intake. But since greens are so healthy for you, you have lots of greens and you maintain that level. A doctor that has a brain cell and knows something about nutrition. Now you say, wait a second, where do you find doctors that know anything about nutrition? Give me a few years. I'm still talking to medical schools. We'll get there. Okay, so what do I think about this kind of 80-10-10 diet, or in general, looking at one's ratios of macronutrients? 80-10-10 tells me nothing about how healthy you eat, right? Because carbohydrates are lentils and lollipops, right? Cotton candy is carbohydrates, but so what? Fat. Fat could be one of the healthiest things on the planet, walnuts, or lard, or hydrogenated oils. Right, what matters to me is the source. And so there are studies showing remarkable health benefits to high-fat plant-based diets, to low-fat plant-based diets, to high-carb, even low-carb plant-based diets. There's this guy, David Jenkins, the guy who invented the glycemic index up at the University of Toronto. He created what he called the Eco-Atkins diet, which is this strictly plant-based but low-carb diet. So you eat lots of avocados and showed remarkable health benefits there too. And so what matters is the source. So, in fact, I encourage people to eat whole plant food sources of fat, such as nuts, seeds, and avocados. In fact, one of my daily dozens. So the first half of the book is reviewing all the science, all the compelling evidence. Second half of the book is how do you actually put it into practice. So it's centered around my daily dozen checklist of all the things I recommend to include in a daily diet. And one of those that got one of those sacred 12, top 12 spots were nuts. So those that eat nuts, and so the Adventist study showed that people eating plant-based who eat nuts live 2 years longer than those that just eat plant-based, right? So you just added years to your life with one simple dietary tweak, and it's delicious. So wait a second, tastes good and you get to live longer? That's what plant-based eating is all about. And the question is about alkaline water. I have a machine that someone sold me saying that it would alkalize my water and improve my health. So I actually have a video about that. You just type in alkaline water, and I think it's called Alkaline Water Scam or No Scam. And spoiler alert, scam. That's the short version. And then it's possible that sprinkling a little baking soda into water may have some beneficial effects, but it's better than, it would cost a penny a week instead of money. So the people that sell alkaline water machines will tell you about the benefits, but unfortunately, it does not seem to be based in science. So, I mean, there's these long chain omega-3 fatty acids, EPA, DHA, found, these so-called marine fats, found in fish. They're so-called essential fats, meaning our body doesn't make them. The fish's body don't make them either. They get them from lower on the bottom in the food chain, these algae that make these long chain omega-3s, and they build up the food chain. The problem is that's not the only thing that builds up the food chain. We live in a polluted world. Essentially, our oceans are humanity's sewers. Everything eventually flows into the sea. So every molecule of mercury that's spewed out by coal-fired power plants eventually settles somewhere, builds up. And so the highest levels of pollutants, toxic heavy metals, PCBs, flame retardant chemicals, kind of on down the list, unfortunately found the aquatic food chain. So if you had a time machine that could go back before the Industrial Revolution, things might be a little different. But now, to reduce one's pollutant load, I encourage people to stay away from fish, from seafood. And where do you get your long-chain omega-3 fatty acids? Well, your body can make them from short-chain omega-3s, from alpha-linolenic acid found in flax seeds and walnuts and other things. I encourage people, one of the daily dozen is a tablespoon of ground flax seeds. One of the reasons is because that'll give you about 2 grams of alpha-linolenic acid. You should be able to make those long-chain omega-3 fatty acids yourself. And if for whatever reason your physician wants to give you long-chain omega-3s directly, like recommends fish oil or something, you can not choose fish oil because even when it's distilled, still has a lot of pollutants in it. They can get rid of the metals, but they can't get rid of some of the lighter persistent organic pollutants. Then you can get algae-based, so you can get pollutant-free sources. Now there's a genetically modified yeast that makes it too, but you can get it from algae or yeast. Get all the long-chain omega-3 fatty acids you want from a pollutant-free source, which is what I would recommend, for example, for pregnant women. So what about reducing inflammation? So yes, so anti-inflammatory food. So turmeric, one of the daily dozen is a quarter teaspoon of turmeric a day. Turmeric is spice you can find anywhere. Tremendous anti-inflammatory effects, so much so that it can be used to treat ulcerative colitis. Works on rheumatoid arthritis better than the leading drug. Also helps with osteoarthritis, on down the list, makes colon polyps disappear. Incredible stuff, got a whole chapter on it. And so if there was one anti-inflammatory food, that would be it. There's a whole bunch of others. If you just type in inflammation on the nutritionfacts.org, they'll all pop up. So yes, indeed, there are some plant foods that are even better than other plant foods, and that's why there's a whole second half of the book. So I'm always on the lookout for studies because I get a question frequently of people who are like, oh, no, I'm sitting on a plane next to somebody, oh, I don't eat a lot of meat, once they hear about what I do. So when my smoking patients come to me, I don't say cut down from 2 packs a day to 1/2 pack a day. I tell them to quit, right? Now, there are some people that actually, so-called social smokers, that can literally pick up a cigarette a couple times a year at a party and put it back down and never get addicted and one would be really hard pressed to make an evidence-based argument that that's harmful. I mean, well, the harm would be you still don't tell people to smoke because that first cigarette may lead to a second cigarette, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So the people, so there are people like a lot of doctors in the plant-based movement that have this 100% absolutely no animal products. They're doing that not because the science says that's the best. They're saying it's because psychologically they know it's easier for people to follow those kind of strict rules. Whereas if you go, I mean, it doesn't really matter what you eat on your birthday or holidays, but if you go on a cruise and start eating really rich foods, when you come back, the concern is that your taste buds have become so accustomed to eat whole natural foods. A ripe peach tastes delicious, but all of a sudden you go on the cruise, you start eating Fruit Loops. You eat a peach after a bowl of Fruit Loops, it'll taste sour. Like, it won't taste good, right? And so all of a sudden, your palate gets all hyper salty, fatty, sweet, and then you go back and all of a sudden your sweet potato doesn't taste very good anymore. The salad doesn't, and then you start going to drive through, and anyway, and you're off the wagon and then you die. Okay, so, but it's not the cruise, it's what, and so the, so just, it, there is a rich psychological literature that ironically, the more restrictions one puts on, if one says, you know, just don't have it in your house, right? If you don't have cookies in your, you know, then you're not tempted. I mean, then if you're you get hungry enough, you're going to eat an apple because that's all there is, right? I mean, you know. And so then you don't have to rely on willpower. I mean, you just, you know, because then what's moderation? You kind of get slippery. Okay. But again, those are psychological, right? And you know yourself, maybe you are a social smoker. Maybe you don't take things to extremes. Maybe you really can't have this ironclad will to be like, I can do this, and then I can not do this for the next 10 years. And I, you know, so you know your psychology best. So that's what I talk about in the book. So then the question becomes, okay, so if they're really, if the hard and fast rule is really psychological and not, you know, physiological, right? If you can smoke once in a while, and technically, not you know, your body can recover from that harm, then what is the level of kind of safe meat consumption? And so I've been, that's an unanswered question, but I've always been desperate to look for studies that ask those kind of questions. And so I do talk about two. In fact, in the introduction to the book, two studies. One, which was a study, interesting study on vegetarians, that then went back to eating meat. And it's like, oh, what happened to them? That's interesting. And they ate a lot less meat than the general population. But what happened was they cut their lifespan by years and all sorts of disease rates shot up. But again, that didn't get at the quantity issue. The best study we have was a study done in Asia comparing two groups of Buddhist monks. And what's nice about Buddhist monks is they didn't travel, they ate, and we knew exactly what they ate the same thing every single day, right? And so we had total control over their diets, right? And so they took these, and in one, they continued to eat strictly plant-based, no eggs, no meat, blah, blah, blah. And the other had like one serving of meat per week, or I think one serving of meat per week for women, and then two or three servings per week for men, something like that. And so what was nice about those two groups is that they had zero soda intake, none of them were eating junk food, processed food. And so it was giving a sense, okay, a traditional Asian diet, which is traditionally very healthy, with just a little meat versus no meat at all. And could you actually tell a difference between those? And if you would have asked me before the study started if there would be a difference, I'd say no. I mean, maybe long term, but not certainly in the short term of the study. I forget how short the study was, a few years. And what happened, there's a dramatic increased risk in diabetes. They were looking at type 2 diabetes. In those that ate just a few servings of meat. And this was like 5% of American meat consumption. Just a few servings a week could dramatically increase. I forget what it was. Someone could open up the book really quick. And so this dramatic increase in risk. None of the vegans got any diabetes. So the statistics are easy. You get lots of diabetes and none diabetes, you get a really big kind of odds ratio. But and so that was the first to suggest, wow, maybe even little amounts. And so what exactly is going on? Is it the heme iron? We're not exactly sure. But so that would argue really more for this holidays birthday kind of thing rather than, you know, so more kind of you know, like these studies done in sub-Saharan Africa and China, they had, you know, like meat every few months. Okay, so that seemed, and they had amazing public health statistics, but it does seem more, that moves the needle from weekly really towards monthly in terms of some safe level, even though we still don't know exactly where that needle eventually lands. So I don't like the kind of labels vegan, vegetarian, because that tells me, as a physician, that tells me what you don't eat, right? So, you know, I used to be at Cornell, had all these vegan friends who lived off French fries and beer. Okay, not particularly health-promoting foods, right? Where someone comes to me and says, I eat a whole food plant-based diet. Ah, I know what you actually eat, right? You actually eat your vegetables. Aha, all right. And so look, some of the unhealthiest foods on the planet, like soda, and, you know, partially hydrogenated vegetable oil like Crisco. It even has vegetable in the title. Worst thing. Worse than lard, right? Okay. So, yes, you actually have to eat healthy. What would I be concerned about most for the health of those eating plant-based diet? Vitamin B12. So vitamin B12 is a vitamin. There's only two vitamins not created by plants. One created by animals, such as yourself when you go out in the sun. Called vitamin D, the sunshine vitamin. It's actually not a vitamin, it's a hormone your skin makes when exposed to sunlight. But unfortunately, at this time of the year, no matter how long you sunbathe naked on the commons today, you are not going to make any vitamin D because the sun's rays are at such an angle. Although it's changing, this is about when it changes. So certainly kind of through February, March, we wouldn't be making any. If you think about it, look, we evolved running around naked in equatorial Africa, us baking in the sun all day. We weren't never meant to live at this, whatever. And all of a sudden we're wearing clothes, whatever. Anyway, so all of a sudden people have vitamin D. So people have vitamin D issues. So if you're not getting adequate sunlight, which is impossible. So if you do Caribbean vacations every weekend, that's fine. But otherwise, you need to take vitamin D here at this latitude during at least the winter months and all year round if you're not getting enough sun in the middle of the day. And so I recommend 2,000 international units of vitamin D every day. What about vitamin B12? Also not made by plants, not made by animals either, made by little microbes that blanket the earth. We used to get all the B12 we needed drinking out of a mountain stream or well water, but now we chlorinate our water supply to kill off any bacteria. So don't get a lot of B12 in our water anymore. Don't get a lot of cholera either. That's a good news. It's great that we live in such a sanitary world. Our fellow great apes get all the B12 they need, eating bugs, dirt, and feces. I prefer supplements. So I encourage people 2,500 micrograms of B12 supplements once a week. That's all you need. Costs less than $5 a year. You'll have all the B12 you ever need. You could also get B12 fortified foods. There's lots of other ways you do it. I have a lot of stuff on my website, and I'm being pushed off the stage. Thank you so much.